This has been a very informative evening, and I want to thank the previous presenters for sharing their research and increasing our appreciation for the marvelously complex organism on which we humans have built our civilizations. I usually use fancy drones like the one you just heard as an introduction in order to focus attention. This time I have included some higher frequencies to keep away visiting rodents that might bite my face as I lay on the ground. Now, to be honest, I am actually not the most appropriate subject to talk to you about plants. I am a vegetarian, but also a carnivore. The plants residing as decoration in my garden in England are corn irrigated, and their containers are square like the square body of Anthropocene soil, or Anthroposoil. Now, I will probably fail to communicate a coherent narrative thread, but I would like you to think of this talk as a kind of Anthroposoil where something has to grow. So first of all, what is Anthroposoil? It is natural soil infested with human-made chemicals or other alteration. It is typically caused by industrial activity, agricultural chemicals, or improper disposal of waste. The most common chemicals involved are petroleum hydrocarbons, polynuclear aromatic hydrocarbons, solvents, pesticides, lead, and other heavy metals. Contaminants typically alter plant metabolism, often causing a reduction in crop yields and creating genetically modified plants. I won't go into further detail, but I want you to keep this type of soil in mind. Make a hole. For now, let's talk about plants. We know that they are very different from us. We know that as animals, we are very specialized about our choice of food. As near as we can tell, eating all kinds of food, from an evolutionary point of view, is a very reckless move indeed, because plants represent a chemical smorgasbord of various types that have accumulated over time in the genome of a particular organism. If you have a very broad-based diet, you are exposing yourself to many kinds of mutagenic influences. As a strategy for survival of species, this is no good. It is much better to specialize, to evolve special enzymatic pathways to deal with toxins. For example, we know certain animals can eat things that other animals would become ill from or even die, and this is the way it's done, and all animal species tend to evolve towards this very bland monodiet. Now, what happens when there is an upheaval in an environment like a geomagnetic reversal, a volcanic eruption, or something like that, and ordinary sources of nutrition become restricted? Then an organism has two choices. 1. Go extinct, starve itself out of existence, or 2. If it has a more flexible behaviors, it can begin to experiment with previously rejected potential foods in the environment. Rejected probably because of strong taste or smell, which are clues to the presence of marginally acceptable chemical compounds of some sort. Our remote canopy living ancestors were fruitarian insectivores. They, under nutritional pressure, began to expand their repertoire of foods. They also began to explore the grassland environments, and grassland environments are par in total number of plant species than the rainforests. Thus, and logically, the potential number of food sources is also limited. So as our remote ancestors began to explore this new environment of the grasslands, they also began to explore new dietary items, and one of the items that they would surely have observed are coprophagic mushrooms, mushrooms which prefer dung. Many of these type of mushrooms elaborate psilocybin, which as I assume you know is one of the major psychoactive alkaloids. And it is not simply its psychoactive properties that make psilocybin a catalyst for human consciousness, it is its psychoactive properties in combinations with other properties that make it uniquely suited to carry out the role of catalysts of consciousness in an animal. What are these unique characteristics? Well, first of all, in very low doses, psilocybin increases visual acuity and edge detection. Edge detection was at a very high premium where predation was taking place, the lion moving on the grass 300 yards away as it creeps upon your camp, or the gazelle trying to sleep away through the tall grass from your hunting party. Edge detection is the key to success or failure in hunting in that kind of situation. Then proto-hominids who would accept psilocybin into their diets would then have a slightly success in hunting. That meant more nutritional resources available for them and their offspring. At higher doses psilocybin would cause arousal, and arousal is simply a feeling of unfocused restlessness. It is that double espresso feeling, sleep is impossible, hands are busy with small tasks, one's feeling of awareness extends further. Now, since we are talking about extending further, I want to go back to plants. Plants don't catch other species for food. Although, as you know, some plants snack on some insects occasionally. Instead they feed on sunlight energy to make food out of thin air and water. They assess the amount and the quality of light, they monitor day length, they have circadian rhythms as we do, of course, different, they respond to gravity, wind, rain, hail, biting insects and animals, and they talk to each other using chemicals, they don't move like we do but experience displacement in space caused by differential growth, a growth towards the light. In a sense, this most basic type of seeing involves the interaction of light with chemicals. Vision also involves chemical reactions with light, only these reactions are coupled to nerve signals that allow the organism to form some kind of image, and this ability is usually associated with a structure called an eye. One distinguishing feature of plants is their ability to harvest light energy. Are we able to harvest light? Do we do it in the form of visual information that fade over the years? When plants do, it increases the amount of energy they can harvest as more of the plant's surface area faces the sun throughout the day, is the reason why this type of heliotropic response did evolve. Can we find ways to move towards the light? Of course, it is possible to grow without light, but in the case of plants, Growth without means its stems grow longer and more rapidly than normally because of a lack of sunlight. In search of light, these plants lose strength, have long internodes, few leaves and look pale yellow or white. This phenomenon is called ideation. Sometimes we can find ideated of plants in cryptoforests. Cryptoforests are social rejects, urban outsiders, forest shaman planners, developers, and neighborhoods with sanitized standards of beautification. Cryptoforests are resilient and grow in forgotten alleys and cracks between the pavement. They grow in poor artificial light conditions, which would be a kind of cryptophotomorphogenesis. They grow with the materials at hand. Dog urinated soil, polluted water, mediocre amounts of potassium, architectural debris, and other anthropogenic particles. In a way, we need them. I agree with Wilfried Hoogjabeg when he says, the ruined clear-cut landscapes of the West have deprived us of truly understanding a part of our own selves. The cryptoforest is its own psychological category, a synthetic mind state all its own. Some cryptoforests are able to survive and outgrow their man-madeness, and some others are removed by city ordinances with sharp metal and motorized tools. In the essay Resist Like a Plant, On the Vegetable Life of Political Movements, Michael Marder attempts to conceptualize the idea of a political movement not on the basis of the traditional animal model, rather, following the lessons drawn from vegetal life. He argues that the spatial politics of the Occupy movement largely conforms to the unique ontology of plants and point towards the possibility of a plant-human republic emerging from it. When we camp in public parks or city squares, lying on the middle of the roadway intersection, sitting on a sidewalk and forming a human bindweed or morning glory with interlocking limbs, manifesting our bond, we surely do not convey the intention to engage in physical confrontation with the police. Why are able to occupy, linger, be determined to dwell in the uninhabitable, the depersonalized, the abandoned but highly symbolic and central places of the public sphere? Have we learned something from the resilient and adaptive nature of vegetal life? We are very different than our green associates. We can able to choose our place and make it our own in a very self-conscious fashion. The plant's relation with its social environment is non-apparative. It doesn't posse its world, even though it may indirectly affect certain changes in its surroundings. In the history of Western thought, plants have always been associated with peace and non-violence. The flower power movement of the 60s thrived on a juxtaposition of peaceful protests and armed police, flowers on one hand and hands on the other. The power of non-violence was meant to overwhelm the brute military repression. And yet, the cutting of the flower, the disruption of its organic connection to the soil, was not considered to be violent, perhaps because it paled in comparison to the brutality of war. In any case, flower power was a kind of powerless power with residual violence against non-human beings. Stand up and carry plant. Unfortunately, I haven't had time to study his Raven A Majesty poem in order to add an intellectual dimension, so I have resolved to pathos and simple appropriation. Again, have we learned something from the resilient and adaptive nature of vegetal life? They certainly have altered our central nervous system and turned our psyche around, hence the word psychotropic, mostly used today as psychoactive. Historically, psychoactive substances have been used by priests in religious ceremonies, healers for medicinal purposes, or the general population in a socially approved way. The broad category of psychoactives consists of natural and synthetic substances that alter a person's thoughts or feelings. There exist hundreds of plants which, if eaten, smoked, snorted, or injected, will affect the mind, whether acting as a stimulant, depressant, or psychedelic. Thousands of known chemicals will do the same. Used recreationally, medicinally, or for work, some are illegal and others not. They include coffee, wine, and tobacco, prescription pain medications, sleep aids, and antidepressants, as well as cannabis, LSD, and heroin. In short, they are known as uppers, downers, psychedelic, and as psychiatric medications. Today psychoactives are pervasive. They are in kitchens, hardware stores, greenhouses, home medicine cabinets, and in fuel tanks across the country. Everyone uses them. You just need to think about all the life decisions you have made under the influence of psychoactives, and where these choices have taken you. Think about for a second, yeah. Right, now underscore. Nearly 90% of 45-year-olds in the United States have tried an illegal drug in their lifetime. Monitoring the Future, MTF, the best current survey about illegal drug use in the United States, reports that 1 in 5 college students use an illicit drug in the past month. Nearly all adults in the U.S. have tried alcohol, while over 80% use caffeine daily. Last year, there were over 180 million prescriptions written for opiates alone, and the diverse assortment of psychoactives are increasingly used by older Americans from coast to coast. Taxpayers spend $8 billion each year to incarcerate drug law offenders and pay for ideologically driven, abstinence-only education programs. You can check the Global Drug Survey if you are interested in going beyond our political borders. Unfortunately, it is common for those on the national stage to use the unqualified term, drugs, when discussing psychoactive substances, as if everyone knows exactly what is meant. This drugs meme has done long-term damage to the public's critical thinking skills due to the unspoken assumption that everyone knows which drugs are the bad ones. Specificity in language is necessary for making good personal decisions, teaching others, and drafting appropriate laws. Evidence of a long-time evolution between plants and animals extends beyond the fact that humans have been using drugs for millennia and that certain plant chemicals closely resemble the neurotransmitters in nerve cell synapses. It is also seen in the adaptations of humans to use the chemicals. These adaptations include enzymes designed to metabolize the chemicals, the ability to smell certain chemicals, and vomiting to expel an overabundance of the substances. Humans are also programmed with detoxification behaviors such as geophagy, the seeking and consuming of dirt and similar materials in order to absorb some of the chemicals. In his book, Intoxication, Life in Pursuit of Artificial Paradise, Ronald Siegel says that humans seem to have evolved to use these chemicals, but what would push humans to pursue psychoactive substances to the extent that they evolved these mechanisms? In other words, why do humans pursue drugs? Siegel held that drugs were and are a biological need. He says the pursuit of drugs is a basic human drive. He calls that fourth drive, a drive so powerful it falls in line with the need for food, water, and sex. So, I think I am losing track. Imagine psychoactives growing on anthropo soil. Plants nurture other plants as they decay. For us, we live in an era of invisible death where death has become filthy. Of course, this is shifting as ecological methods of disposing the body are being proposed, such as the mycelial suit that works as decomposition activator. Green burial activists are trying to bring awareness into how deathly regular burial practices are as thousands of tons of wood and concrete are used to maintain necropolitan areas, and cremation releases large amounts of mercury into the air, ground, and water as bodies are burned. Some soil areas that have been bioturbated for the creation of mass graves show concentrations of chamomile or daisies being pushed up by decomposing bodies. This is human bodies literally becoming plants. Depending on soil characteristics, plant growth rates may be taller or shorter than surrounding plants. This can be observed from an aerial perspective during growing seasons. Now, can we look at plants and see humans? Ours is trailblazing in the fields of bio and ecosystem sensing, transducing. Plant-generated magnetic fields translated into sound. Our ventriloquist desire to make them talk. Like us, they are information processing organisms that operate collectively as networks builders like us. They operate not as individuals as multiplicities consisting of many body parts. Thanks to our cultural prejudices, arrogance, and lack of multi-temporal education, we see them as sedentary passive objects rather than active subjects encouraging us to be nomadic. Plants exist in a completely different time dimension that we do. They need to work together as biotic and abiotic collaborators. Insectoids, androids, gynoids, plantoids, and hopefully weatheroids. The reason why visualizations of the internet are so similar to root systems is because they both evolved in order to survive predation. Who are our predators as human animals? What oppressive regimes feed on humanity? Plants can give us suggestions on how to evolve networks because they are webs engaged in trans-species coevolution. Contemporary science now encourages the perspectives of indigenous animisms that have always recognized plants as relational intelligent bodies who deserve respect and acknowledgement as any other living being. Plants are affected by light that falls into the blue spectrum of the light scale. Daylight, fluorescent light and grow lights all have blue tones in them and will help provide the light your plant needs. Incandescent and halogen lights are more red and will not help your plant grow. Please close your eyes. Please close your eyes. Please close your eyes.